TA's got a bad rap. This system has changed a lot within the last 10 years.
The New York City Transit Authority is having some success. This is the number 4 line, formerly one of the worst in the entire system. Today, it's one of the best.
Too many bitch niggas out there thinking something sweet about the 4 line.
10 years ago, the subway system was the pits.
Today, we got better equipment.
Definitely not perfect. We have a long way to go, but we're getting there.
They are working on it. They're doing the best they can.
I can't convince you unless you go down and see for yourself.
Hey, train coming from the other side. Hey, train coming from the other side, bro.
We see the
evidence. We see it.
Working.
We're not there yet.
When it'll be finished, it'll be lovely.
It'll be better.
You have to be patient.
Let
these things take time.
Yes, I agree with her.
Downstairs, Jay. What? Get out of here, Jake!
Quick removal of the scribbling appears to be the strongest deterrent so far because it frustrates the writer's desire for recognition.
Yo, all these motherfuckers out there sweating trains. Y'all niggas ain't been hitting no trains.
We've brought New York a long way in the past few years. One of the things we won't tolerate anymore is graffiti. We got it off the subways, but there are still a lot of idiots out there trying to turn our streets into an eyesore.
You got a bomb everywhere, man. Fuck a train. You got to hit everything.
So this time, we're getting tough.
Stick together, it will work.
In your face, punk.
Vandalism. Vandalism. Don't be a pain in their motherfucking ass.
Taggers admit that the Transit Authority seems to be winning the battle against subway graffiti. The battle, not necessarily the war.
I don't want to be afraid.
We have guys out there in plain clothes. We have guys out there to apprehend criminals.
Give me 8 hours every day. I'm out there doing my job.
I mean, I feel more secure when I see cops around.
You're going to see 30% more cops in this subway system.
I'm assuming that this is no longer on this train.
It could have ran for a day.
People that come on to my subway are coming into my house.
I haven't given up, but I think we have to really get tough.
I'm not giving up. My cops aren't giving up. And New Yorkers shouldn't give up.
The train bombers were like, I want to hit as many trains on as many different lines. Now that's one very specific thing. With streets, there's 800 different neighborhoods in the 5 boroughs. So trying to cover that territory, you got to be really dedicated to the game.
Yo, after the trains died, a lot of people went onto the highways. Everybody had a big chunk of highway in different parts of the city.
The trains were a moving canvas. Back in the 70s and 80s, they weren't thinking about that. They were thinking about the trains. It goes from borough to borough. They weren't thinking about placement. They were thinking about motion. When they took the motion away from us, now it was more footwork. It evolved from the train era to the streets.
A lot of people, when the trains died, they were like, oh, you know, you hear people to this day, if it's not on the trains, it's not gonna be like, fuck that shit, because there's people who kept going. The JAs, the RDs, I respect that. Those people kept going. It was a lot of people that cost it revs.
I was bombing streets back in 85 when niggas was bombing trains and all that. I had my little fair share of the trains, but I always loved the streets.
A lot of people were already fucking the streets up, like Easy, Jaws, TK. They were already out there. They already, like, the streets were already a game. It would be truthful, the streets were a game before the subways, originally. Originally it was the streets, the buses, then the subways. But a lot of people actually, some people never even really hit the subways and just hit the streets. Yeah, like Easy, TK, Jaws, Josh 5. To me, those are the street kings.
Those are the first ones to really go all city everywhere, like on almost every fucking gate that you could look at.
You know, Easy, Josh 5, Jaws, rest in peace, and TK were like the first people to really go all city with tags on the streets. And that was before the trains were actually gone. That was like around 84.
Star Wars, 80s period of time, 84, 85 maybe at the latest.
OE3.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying, OE and them, OE13.
A diehard street bomber, yeah, even when the trains were in.
When did like the pedal hit the fucking metal? About 90-91.
Then as the 90s progressed, probably like early 90s, you know, you would see more fill-ins and the gates and the walls started getting gone over, the tag walls, because that was the original. People didn't really do fill-ins. It started getting more prevalent in the mid-90s.
So the streets were pretty bombed. I just don't think that people, it was that much of a thing. People didn't really care so much. People were just riding on the streets for fun. There was some people that were majorly obsessed with doing it and repeating it over and over and over and over again, but it just wasn't like a thing like the trains were. It became a thing after a couple of years, like early 90s when I started. It was just like a thing. People were doing it. Everyone had a tag. They were writing on the streets.
It's a lot of people, but Sane Smith, definitely, that's a legendary duo right there.
Sane with his brother Smith were putting in some of the most output when graffiti went back to the streets starting in the 90s.
One of the first stories that I heard about was Sane, and I remember going to the Amtrak's 89, the first time I ever seen the huge straight letter top to bottom. It was on a freight train, and it was a Sane straight letter, huge, white filling, black outline. And my boy was like, yeah, that dude died, that he fell off the Brooklyn Bridge or something like that.
Think about prolific spots. Hitting Brooklyn Bridge is that you're getting instant notoriety that is gonna be long lasting. You hit the Brooklyn Bridge, you bring a lot of heat upon yourself, but you still hear about when Sane and Smith hit it decades ago. Whoever's hit that bridge has gone down in infamy.
There's multiple stories. Either he fell off, or they, meaning the cops, pushed him off. You know, that's the word through the grapevine. I don't know in actuality what it is.
The story isn't 100% clear. What happened was in 1990, Sane was writing graffiti on the Brooklyn Bridge and he fell to his death. Now there's a couple different stories about how this happened and rumors are a mess.
I was told that that's not how he passed away, or I feel like I read somewhere that that's not how he passed away.
No one really knows, but Smith and Sane were facing a trial for vandalism and Sane passed away, so the trial got postponed, and then something happened with Smith's lawyer passing away. And that somehow ended the scenario. I don't know if City Hall had amnesty for them.
I just know that it was like a legendary story. And I remember seeing like Smith and Sane, Smith and Sane, Smith and Sane. I remember going into tunnels for the first time and the shit was like on every pole under every tunnel in Manhattan.
Smith and Sane were hitting all the pillars in the tunnels. The MTA subway system was still being hit with graffiti. It just wasn't on the trains anymore. It went into the tunnels and the outdoor tracks.
He definitely was an inspiration to many all across the board, amongst all groups, because of his original style, his dedication to the game, his ability to transition from train to street, to finding original spots, going in the tunnels, going to dead spots, utilizing bucket paint.
They were some of the first bombers that really did streets and tunnels, and they continued.
I feel like maybe the MTA does a little bit of give and take. It's like, yo, fuck it. If these guys aren't bombing the trains, let them have the walls. So now that people weren't doing trains anymore, the streets opened up. So it became about hitting gates.
When the trains ended, there were gate chains.
It was mainly the roll down gates.
The pull down gates, that was the epitome of 90s graffiti. Fill-ins on gates with a little shadow and a border, catch a tag by it. And that was just what graffiti was refined to.
All the walls, you know, anything you could imagine, trying to climb up the bridge, doing heaven spots.
The size of building walls with different stock cap tags, fat cap tags, a good variety of tags.
It became about trucks.
Truck yards. Trucks became the new subway train. A truck was more likely to travel through random blocks that a train would never even go to. People were writing just as much graffiti on trucks in the 90s and 2000s as there was graffiti on the subway. So whether they be on the street or sneaking into a truck yard.
So you're gonna paint the highways, you're gonna paint the streets, you're gonna paint the rooftops, you're gonna wanna find a spot that your name can exist for as long as it possibly can, hopefully permanently. Perm spots.
It was like new terrain that everyone was overlooking for all these years, but then the trains were gone. So people, you know, went back to writing their name and graffiti on the wall, but it was like a lot of specific spots.
A spot is a place that you have carved out for yourself. A place that you peeped, you schemed, you figured out how to get to, and you took?
A spot is anything that you see would be worth risking your freedom. Whether it's a fire escape, if it's a pillar, really perilous ledge spots, if it's a subway wall, if it's a rooftop.
Mailboxes with markers.
I used to like the Uni paint markers. That was my go-to markers.
You just bought
silver in the front, black in the back.
Shoes, kid.
Signs in the street, little quickies.
Stickers.
If it's a disabled car, any spot that it will have long lasting effects. If you could hit it and it'll run for a little while, that's a good spot.
Well,
scratchies was a thing. I used to love doing scratchies, man. That's another one. You know, it was like when you couldn't paint the trains no more, what you do? Hit the windows. Same thing. Instead of it being paint, now it was the scratches on the windows.
I did a few. I never seen them again. So I don't know what they do with those windows.
Scratchy was going on. You would see the one line, you had sill, 5x7, you had vise and pipe. You had a whole bunch of writers that were scratching the insides of trains in the early 90s.
Before, you wouldn't be able to see anything out the window. Like, what train stop is this? Too much scratchy. I can't see nothing.
And a lot of these little nitty gritty places were really hard to photo document. People got to know each other from seeing the smallest little things. It became sneaky. There were a lot of places where you could, you know, really choose a good spot and it could be seen by just as many people as an old train back in the day.
Style was very important, but also a very quick style that could be done in under a minute. So it was like quick throwies that looked clean, that didn't look like the next man's lettuce.
The name of the game was to get in there and get out. I think that's why, if you look at the early 90s graph, it was mainly like stock cap tags with connections. It was like we tried to connect the whole tag because it was quicker. You just, I think that kind of created those types of quick hands on.
To me, I always trying to do this shit as fast as possible. Always try to train myself. Sometimes, like, even when I'm doing like a safe spot, I try to paint fast because it keeps you on your toes for when you're doing your shit in a hot boy spot.
Some people feel like it's better to bomb during the winter. It's definitely better to be in a jail cell during the winter than in the summer. I've been busted in the summer and it's not fun being in a jail cell when it's like 100 degrees outside.
I would take advantage of a snowstorm, but that's not my all, like, plan. I didn't really give a fuck. I actually don't like it when it's kind of quiet out, because that's when I feel like the police have more of a time to and just spot you and right up to you, you know what I mean? It's like it's just traffic and shit, and you just look and you can tell by headlights and makes of cars and stuff like that.
You gotta pick your time for what you're gonna do.
The best time to go bombing is all the time. Because it's time to bomb all the time. You got to be true to bombing.
Is all graph bombing? Hell fucking no. Bombing is when you go out there and you're doing it to an extent that people take notice and it's overstated. It's to the average person who knows nothing about graffiti notices it. That's what bombing is.
Bombing is not having permission to go out and paint. Bombing is preparation. When you have permission to do a spot, that's not bombing. That's legitimizing graffiti. That's not bombing. Bombing is getting your knapsack full with paint, going out in the middle of the night, you and your peoples, or you by yourself, and you painting non-stop, not caring about whatever it is. You're going block to block, corner to corner, avenue to avenue, borough to borough, and just doing what you gotta do. That's bombing.
Bombing, yeah, that's a whole different animal. It's like when the trains went dead, it would just be like from here, you could do it to the Fifth Avenue and back. We would just go down the street, like fucking like it's the inside of a subway car. Just, no, I'm serious, we just do it like RD, D3, RD, you know, just, you know, it's, I mean, it's even been written up in like the Village Voice or Town Magazine. It was like, you know, it's really.
If the army went to a city they were invading and you heard they're dropping bombs, it means exactly that. Total destruction, complete annihilation, just trying to drop and blow up in as many places as possible. To me, if you tell me we're going bombing, that means that we're gonna write our names in as much fucking shit as possible and hope that we don't get fucking caught.
You leave your house with a bag full of paint and you actively hit multiple spots.
I was going to every tunnel mouth that existed in the train system for like 20, 30 cans and just covering the whole tunnel mouth. And I did that from 99 to 2000. That's what you call bombing. You go someplace with a backpack filled with fucking paint and you empty out every last fucking can. That's a bomb.
And I think because everybody started bombing in the streets more and hitting up different neighborhoods, because the goal was to become all city, that's when the streets of New York got a little bit mixy.
All city, yo. Take over. Hey, stop. We ain't gonna stop, yo. You gonna be the hottest shit out here.
You wanna be a bomber. You wanna say you're all city king. You wanna say you're that. Hit everything.
All city's funny because it's almost now a title you have to impose on yourself. Like, all city is, you have to go, you have to be seen up everywhere. You have to be seen up along the Deeg, and you have to be seen up by Westchester. You have to be seen all over Queens, all over Brooklyn, all over Manhattan, and in Staten Island. You know, this title that everybody strives to have, which is trying to get your name up in every inch of the five boroughs of New York.
All city is where you have fill-ins, tags, straight letters, pieces in all five boroughs. You have to have not just one, you gotta have multiple. And it's not just, oh, I have one over here, one there. No, you gotta actually go there like you live there and start painting like you're from there.
Every time you go all city, that's the same as getting a platinum record. So I got multiple platinum.
You gotta hit everything, man. This is the fucking world, man. It's the world to take. You know what I'm saying? Do that. Take that shit over.
It's not everyone's main objective. It wasn't mine's. I wanted to before, you know, but I'm from Manhattan. As long as I got Manhattan, to me, it's not the biggest deal. I grew up in Manhattan, so I want to have make sure I always have Manhattan.
You see, the trick to Manhattan is all entrances and exits, you get them locked down, right? Bridges, shit like that, tunnels. Then you fuck with the gas stations. Around all the gas stations, you get those areas, right? And you could just pretty much duck and weave. And when you duck and weave, back then, you would want to get more around like club areas. You would want to concentrate hard. Up until 59th Street, you just go river to river. 59th Street, it's far down from the East River, from the FDR Drive, all the way over to the West Side Highway. And you don't got to worry about 59th Street anymore. And the next one, 60th. Then boom, you keep ducking and weaving. And you can also pay more attention to actual big hubs like 14th Street, 42nd Street, 59th Street, 86th Street, 125th Street, 116th Street. 3-4 months, someone could just totally have Manhattan Island in the palm of their hand. I've done it myself like 7-8 times. He's done it many times over and over. Because it's all numbers and shit. It's not like Brooklyn. It gets all like this and shit. Manhattan, it's like a fucking graph, like a blueprint architectural paper, the graph paper. It's simple as fuck.
It just depends what you want. Some people want to be, you know, the best neighborhood writer. Some people want to have the dopest hand style. Some people want to do the dopest pieces. Some people want to be up all over the place. But yeah, if you're talking about bombing, that's the objective, to get up the most.
I like how people, graffiti writers, are collectors. They see something and that's their thing, and that's how they have to write on it. You have like Send 4 and the Dumpsters and Send Johnny Pumps.
Real street bombing, gutter. I've been doing this since 1984. Street bombers. Jaws, rest in peace.
And you have Put with his Mean Street tags everywhere, low spots. I like that people, graffiti writers, are collectors, and that's their thing, and no matter what, they have to do that. That makes me excited.
Fame is putting in work and getting your respect and having your name ring bells, or just, you know, getting your name out there.
Be the king of trucks, be the king of roofs. You fucking be the king of tunnels, and then the streets start talking. And then, boom, you become famous.
Also, I mean, if you're trying to go all city, it's impossible to afford, so, you know.
You ain't buying the paint, you know what I'm saying? You're a real writer, you ain't buying that shit anyway, you know what I'm saying?
We catch you taking your paint money, rolled up, taking all that shit.
Also, people try to shit on roller paint graffiti. Oh, you're doing rollers. I'm like, have you seen people? It's not like you going out with a couple of cans and fat caps and doing this real fast. You gotta fucking lay down a tray and this shit. And you got, that shit isn't really easy at all. Yo, to me, yo, I love all forms of vandalism.
Before Karsten Remsen and we're doing paint rollers, I've done paint rollers, you've done paint rollers. People have done that. People would write Van Halen or something with a roller behind some shopping mall strip in Long Island or something like that, or Carlos Santana or whatever. God is love.
That big know? Baby blue RD you did with paint rollers way before fucking
Carson
Reds were using rollers.
But, I've done bigger shit before they were really doing it. We've done the boiler up in the Bronx.
That's right.
And Harlem River facing.
We did this gigantic boiler.
Revs and Cost, they brought paint rolling to a different level.
Walking down the street and seeing broken windows? Are you? Yeah. How about finding that the side of your home or your school has been painted with graffiti? Yeah. Tell me, are you sick of it? Yeah. All right, I hear ya. Well, right in front of you are young people who say they commit those kinds of crimes. Meet Revs. He says he expresses himself with his graffiti, even if taxpayers have to pay for it. And next to him is Cost, who says no one can stop him from achieving his goal, covering all of New York with his graffiti garbage. You spread graffiti all over New York. What? Is that your fan club here, I guess?
Revs, he's an influential figure in the sense that he's such a, I mean, he's like sort of an outsider in a way, but he's like a legendary person.
My name's fucking Revs. F-U-C-K-I-N, R-E-V-S. And I'm a writer, graffiti writer.
When I moved here, he was this person that was doing something in between art and graffiti.
About 1980, 1981 is when I got into punk rock, graffiti. I never looked back since, and I don't give a damn about hardly nothing in this world. I started posting up bills. And then at the same time, I seen Cost post bills. I called them up, and we had the same exact philosophy.
We fought the Buff as a graffiti group on a whole as the 80s wore on. They fought if they ended the trains, that was it. But obviously, the graffiti writers were never going to actually stop. It's just we were going to find a different place. And it was kind of like the streets were the next option. And the police at the time weren't really prepared for what graffiti is now. My cohort and I, Revs, at the time, we were bored with the structure of graffiti, and we actually hated graffiti and was revolting against the whole process of how graffiti was being defined at the time. And we just said, hey, let's switch it up and just said, let's make different moves. And we started painting the streets, painting in doorways, throwing canvases up in parking lots, weed pasting. We got involved in a lot of postering, and it sort of just snowballed from there.
They opened up this whole entire world of possibilities. It wasn't about street bombing no more. Now it was a whole different venue of wild, insane places to hit up.
It was just like, fuck everything, fuck everybody. Let's just take over and shove it down their motherfucking throats, man. And that's what we did. We just went ass wild on the city. And by 95, I guess the city just had enough of us.
We have a sampling of your work around New York. Let's show the tape.
Now tell me it's unpleasant to look at.
All right, here we got Mount Crushmore, which we did not too long ago. This is the type of stuff that a lot of people are coming down on when they really shouldn't. Nothing's off limits in this city. Public space is there for the taking, and we take whatever public space we feel necessary.
Revs, he pushed the boundaries with his innovations, and he kept creating them. And some people will never innovate or ever do something different. They'll just do graffiti well over and over and over again. But Revs changed the game by doing these things that were different. Like the weldings were really interesting, and they're still around. And it was more about permaculture as opposed to something that can get painted over, because you can't paint over it, you can only just rip it down. It was actually physically changing the landscape.
You could say this is an eyesore, but other people will say it's
fucking amazing, groundbreaking. He definitely changed the game with that. It was Revs and Cost all day, two of my all-time favorites.
I like the video of him trying to put that metal statue on 8th Street, and then the cops roll up and he like throws, he like lets go of the metal statue and it falls on the cop car and smashes the whole front of the cop car. Yeah, that was hilarious.
Yeah, the whole welding shit, I like it. It's cool. It's definitely interesting. He's one dude, you know, he bounces to his own beat. You know, the same with Cost, and to a certain degree.
Well, we're into free expression and take to the streets in New York City.
A lot of the time people, they ignored it. They knocked it because it was a different trend from what graffiti standards were. And we weren't really accepted by the art world, but we didn't want to be. So we were kind of crossing over into a risky area at the time. And a lot of people were angry at what we were doing. When it came to the graffiti guys, they said it didn't matter, it doesn't count, they're not using spray paint. But we stuck with what we were doing and we're focused on self-expression and not necessarily just reaching the graffiti writers. We were trying to reach the whole public.
Revs' Welding's next level. Next level still to this day, next level. There will always be next level.
Writing with paint is not just not adding anything but a layer of paint. You're only changing it in two dimensions. He brought it to a new dimension, literally.
Revs, what do you do for a living?
I'm an iron worker.
If you are an iron worker, when do you find time to work on your art?
Late at night. I have to work. This is my passion. This is what I have to do. This isn't a money-making scam.
Dude, fucking apocalypse happens. Them sis might survive. Awesome, like Egyptian shit. They're gonna find Rev's fucking sculptures in the rubble. Like, what is this?
And the metalwork. You see where I'm at? Yo, Rev, if you're watching this, I would like to put one over there somewhere.
So everybody sees it and they have no choice but to look at it.
And the stories in the subway tunnel was also very innovative. It was more than one innovation, more than one claim to fame.
Revs put it upon himself to write a book inside of the subway tunnels.
Doing it on a level that's not really cognizant of fine art or being like a street artist or something like that, but just more of like an outsider who was a graffiti writer and then just like to interface with the places that he liked to go, which are some of the untraveled places, which is places I always like to get, you know, like I always try to sneak into whatever is around me.
You're right, but you say it's public space, but these are on private buildings.
Public, private?
It doesn't matter. We're taking what we want because we're taxpayers also.
Right.
We're taxpayers. And we deserve the streets as much as you do. Everybody deserves the streets in this audience. And everybody's got a right to say something.
A couple times when I was in the tunnels, you just climb into a little spot and then you look, well, I didn't even notice the Rose piece, but then I look out and I see the Rose diary and you just sit there and read it. I think that's a brilliant way of giving your writing or your thoughts to the people, because that's a very bizarre type of person that's climbing around in the tunnels and they're the only ones that are gonna really have the time to sit there and read it. And that's amazing.
Alongside that, he would also just do a huge block letter Revs roller, and he would do a lot of wordplay, just so many different things.
People, they gravitate towards something that's different, but still, it's still graffiti. He made something new.
It looks gross. It makes the city look worse. I think people putting their tags on buildings and just scrawling unidentifiable nonsense is trash.
Well, I think that graffiti art really ruins the facade of the building.
Artists do have a right to, like, express themselves, even though it's public or private property.
Just recently, New York State made acts of graffiti a misdemeanor, and penalties range from 15 days to a year in jail. That doesn't stop Revs and Cost.
CO got bagged. He got 5 years probation. He got 3,000 hours community service. He got fined. That's when I went underground.
I would just love going in the tunnels and seeing. Sometimes you can find a little nook and just sit there, and then like the trains can go by. You can actually just sit there for a second, and there's actually a Revs diary page in front of you. You could actually just read it.
You want to say something, ma'am? Yes.
I think that what Cost and Revs are doing is fine, because they're out there, they're earning their living, they're paying taxes just like I am. I write graffiti too. And as long as it's not infringing on anybody else's life.
If it's on private property and the people that own the property have a problem, then it's a problem.
But see, Mayor Giuliani is coming down right now on the quality of life crimes, and graffiti happens to be one of them.
There are a lot of people out there that are raping people, murdering people, stealing people's cars, selling drugs. I'd rather see those people get punished than people who are running around with a spray paint can writing graffiti.
Yeah!
Right?
Yes, you want to say something?
This is cost. Co-starring with Jerry Orbach. This show was in the early 90s. This was all over the city. It was changing everything. And that shows you how prominent his work was and how legible it was.
More and more taggers are relying on video, thanks to the help of graffiti bomber turned producer Carl Weston.
You're promoting graffiti.
Oh yeah, we are. There's no ifs or ands about it. I promote graffiti.